Good evening. Welcome to Leeds University Business School. If you are unfamiliar with this place, welcome to a talk tonight by Lord Skidelsky on is there a better way to do economics? Why are you here? Well, possibly because economics education reform is in the news, which strikes me as a bizarre state of affairs, but there we are. It is. And one of the other reasons you might be here is because you heard about students revolting. So, in that spirit, and to note that this event has actually been co-organised by the Economics Division and by the Open Group here at Leeds, I introduce to you Chris Harley.
So yeah, as Andrew said, this is both the final guest speaker event Open is running this year, and also the first one we have jointly organised with the business school. We're also here as part of something called ISIPE's Global Action Day. ISIPE is the International Student Initiative, Pluralism in Economics. It's a network of over 100 groups in 30 countries spread across 6 continents. It's truly a global initiative. And all of these students across the world work in different ways to try and change how economics is taught and how it's understood, both by students and the wider public. So today there's about 20 groups spread across the world who are running events to celebrate the second anniversary of the establishment of ISIPE. And it's a shared vision for a form of economics which is better at understanding society and can be used to create a better world.
Okay, thank you, Chris. And we're proud at Leeds to say that there's a tradition here of doing this kind of economics. So our students don't complain. Okay, thank you, Chris. And I should also, while I'm thinking of that, thank Helen. Division assistant for all the fantastic work she's done to help organise this event. So thank you, Helen. Right, can I now introduce then Lord Robert Skidelsky? He's got an extensive biography, so I'll just pick out a couple of things. He's Emeritus Professor at the University of Warwick and probably best known for his biographies of John Maynard Keynes. He's also now in the development of an alternative curriculum for economics, and this talk today is part of the development of that curriculum. So, without further ado, Lord Skidelsky.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity to be here and try out some of the ideas I've been working on recently. And this is very much work in progress. I've been asked to do a series of 12 lectures for a MOOC, which is going to be screened by INET early in the new year, on the philosophy and history of economics. And it's part of a project to see whether one can develop an alternative curriculum. I struggle hard to get them to accept it, and most of the money they've allocated, I have to say, is going not on developing the new curriculum, but filming it. But that may be a good thing, because it'll be well done. And this is work in progress. So I'd be very, 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 very appreciative of feedback. Some of the ideas I'm going to put forward this evening may strike you as half-baked, in which case you must tell me. And I regard it as the start of a conversation rather than as a lecture. But let me start anyway with a quotation from the great economist Alfred Marshall, who wrote in 1888, "It always seems to me that some apology is needed for talking about economic method, when we never bother ourselves about method in the other sciences." Of course, that was in the aftermath of one of the great debates about method in the 19th century between the classical school, the Anglo-American classical school, and the German historical school. That then subsided. And the next great discussion was the tumult created by the Keynesian Revolution, and that then subsided. So there have been these periods when people have talked about method because they thought that the methods being used were wrong. Then it settled down again, and usually they went back to the same method as they had in the past. We get to the point when Paul Samuelson could write in 1956, "Economics is the queen of the social sciences." Why did no one see it coming? Asked a real queen. Queen Elizabeth II, a great shortly after the world economy collapsed. The Queen was not asking for an explanation of why it happened, but why caught economists unaware. The quick answer is because it was no more supposed to happen than an earthquake in London. But it did happen, and economics suddenly found itself in a sort of crisis, certainly in a mess. And its reputation didn't collapse as rapidly as the economy collapsed, but it did suffer a sharp fall. People began to ask, what good is economics if it can't warn us that the world economy is about to crash? Now, no discipline should be condemned for a single predictive failure. Much of this failure was down to inattention. Most professional economists were working on other things, other problems. I mean, you can't expect the whole of the discipline to be focused on one particular area, which is the financial economy. But nevertheless, the failure of those whose job it was to look for telltale signs of breakdown do need to be criticised, especially macroeconomists, banking economists, financial economists, financial journalists. It's their job to look at these things, and somehow they were not equipped to detect warning signals, of which there were a number. For example, the Case-Shiller Home Price Index. Everyone could see that house prices were going through the roof and that what's called a correction was inevitable. What they didn't understand was how housing crash in one part of the United States could cause an implosion of the world banking system. That was beyond their understanding. That failure was not really accidental. It reflected a long-standing neglect by economists of money and banking. Banks are simply intermediaries. They transmit messages, they don't send them. And that reflected a theoretical bias which could be variously described as a bias towards equilibrium thinking or a bias towards real analysis as opposed to analysis which included money. And that bias ignored Keynes's great insight that economic theory was a monetary theory of production. Monetary theory. Or it was completely irrelevant. The idea that money, when all said and done, doesn't really matter, is still alive and well in economics, despite all experience to the contrary. You see, of course, economists understand that economies are prone to shocks. The language of shocks itself is interesting, but What they thought about really were real shocks. They ignored the possibility that technical innovation in banking might, such as securitization, the development of credit default swaps, collateral default, could be even more shocking. So this is my excuse for talking about method. Unless we revise the way economics is done and taught, it'll turn out to be a useless guide to action when we need it most. And we will need it again, because this is the first of many crashes that we can expect. explain why, but I'll go on to the basic question. What use is economics? Well, some people reply, and we want to understand why some countries are rich and others poor. I think, I asked an unrepresentative sample of students why they want to do economics, and one of the answers is to understand why some countries are rich, others poor, why some people within those countries are rich and others poor. One person said to me, want to earn a lot of money. I could say, maybe you're deluded, maybe this isn't the royal path to millionaire status. Want to know why the world economy is falling apart. Understanding the world. These are all pretty standard types of answers you'd expect to get. Students often say they study economics to understand the economy, to make the world a bit of it a better place. And that seems to me a worthy motive. The question is, does the economics they'll be taught live up to their expectations? Or is it selling them a pup? Is it a false prospectus? And I think that's really what I want to talk about tonight. What is economics trying to tell us with its models and statistics? Is it telling us about real things, or just telling us about itself? Well, what is economics? There are two alternative answers. The first is that it studies something called the economy, which is roughly the organisation which produces our food, clothes, shelter, and many of the other goods we want. The giant household, as the Greeks thought of it. But there's another meaning of economics expressed in such phrases as fuel economy, or she's very economical with her suppers, or something like that. And what economy here means is efficiency in doing whatever it is we do. Not doing more than necessary to achieve whatever it is we want to achieve, whether it's in the economy or in any other walk of life. There's an economics of marriage, there's an economics of music, there's an economics of many things, even economics of, many economics has invaded, if you like, many fields and applied the principle of economizing to those areas it studies. Efficiency, then, requires calculating cause and effect. A calculating person is rationing time and money. As the saying goes, time is money. And in that sense, all activities that we engage in can be said to have an economic aspect. On this definition, economics studies the calculating side of human behaviour. And that's how economics is usually defined today. Lionel Robbins famously called it the science which studies behavior as a relationship between unlimited wants and limited resources which have alternative uses. That was in 1932. A recent text just echoes him. Economics is the study of how people, firms, and economies as a whole allocate their scarce resources so as to satisfy their unlimited desires. Straight parroting of the 1932 definition, and you'll find that in most textbooks. Now, what this definition does is to set up efficiency as the standard of rational behaviour. But there are a few hidden traps in this way of looking at economics. Here are a couple. It says that wants are unlimited. What justification is there for that? The stomach is pretty elastic, but the belt can't be made to stretch forever. The psychologist Abraham Maslow proposes a hierarchy of needs stretching from lower to higher. And Skidelsky, who's also written about on this, has the same kind of hierarchy in his head. This goes beyond the simple needs of the body to the sort of higher needs, but it's still a far cry from unlimited wants. In psychology, a person with insatiable desires is regarded as needing treatment. In economics, this is the standard assumption. Now, talking about human wants in isolation like this means the economist doesn't have to inquire into the source of the origins of these wants or into the value of these wants. In the jargon, the economist takes preferences as given. And the language of wants, if you talk about wants in this unanchored way, it pushes you into talking about individuals who, after all, are the only unwanting, are the only wanting agents. You know, nothing else wants, and it's individuals who want things. And so you're driven to methodological individualism. I mean, that's how you get there. And you're also, by the way, driven into relativity, because preferences are taken as given. You don't interrogate them in any way. You just take them as data for your model construction. And secondly, the second trap is the limited resources trap. In economics, economic jargon, every activity has an opportunity cost. Everything we do is at the expense of something else. But that needs to be questioned. That obviously isn't true. First, it contains the idea that our human and physical resources are fully stretched. The budget constraint it underlies that. In fact, the jobs most people do don't fully stretch them at all. So that's one way in which our resources aren't fully stretched. And as for the economy, we know that for long periods resources are underemployed, and that through innovation, economies add to their resources. So economics can't just be about allocation. It has to be about employment and growth as well. And then there's another trap. Which is a subtler one, I think. The Robbins definition presupposes we can calculate the cost of choosing one thing rather than another. In many cases, we clearly can't. Costing a choice presumes at least probabilistic knowledge of the consequences of making that choice. This is generally not available for events stretching far into the future. For example, how much does an evening spent with friends rather than working on one's essay cost one in terms of lifetime income foregone? Anyone who tries to work out this, the impact of an evening's work on their degree grade, on their future impact of their degree grade on their future earnings, and then discounting their future earnings by the pleasure they have from an evening with friends, would be rightly considered mad. And yet, that's what a rational person should be doing. Now, most economists, non-economists, find economists' obsession with calculation repellent. It's the thing which perhaps most cuts economics off from other ways of understanding human behavior. It makes out human beings to be calculating machines. It seems to imply that we're always counting the cost of doing something. But we know that's not true. We do lots of things and we don't literally count the cost at all. Not just because we can't, but because we don't want to. Nor do we find agreeable the idea that time spent with our friends or lovers is a cost which, for efficiency's sake, we would do well to minimise. So, economics lends itself, I think, or the economic way of thinking lends itself to a certain type of cynicism. The cynic, Oscar Wilde said, is a person who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. And there is just a tendency, if you get into this way of thinking, for separating price from value. Once you have set up the drama of life as a contest between unlimited wants and scarce resources, you have forced behavior into the mold of a strategic game, which can only be played by calculation. So, if economics is just about allocating scarce resources, it can't claim to supreme authority as a guide to life. I mean, that seems to me pretty obvious. Let's retreat to the first and safer ground of economics as a study of how societies organise the getting of wealth. This was Adam Smith's purpose in his great foundational work, An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations, 1776. For Smith, economics was a new religion. It was the science which would open up a heaven on earth. And many students were attracted to economics exactly for that reason. It is the science of welfare, and welfare is improved by creating wealth, even though the two are not by any means the same, as I'll say in a minute. If your aim is to make people richer, though, almost the first question you will want to ask is why are some people in every country and some countries as a whole poor and others rich? And that's a question that constantly comes up. Moreover, it's not at all clear that the gap between rich and poor is closing. In fact, rather the reverse. And here's something one wants to say now in favour of economics. It's only because of economics that we have this information about what's happening to wealth and income. Economics has furnished us with conceptual categories like wealth and income, which can be measured in terms of money. We can, of course, question whether these measures actually measure how well off people are or feel they are. That's why some economists are keen to supplement them with measures of happiness or well-being, which are much less easily measured. However, let's accept that if you are very poor, you are less likely to feel happy than if you are even moderately well off. So the aim of getting rid of poverty is, after all, a worthy aim. And a worthy aim for all, and for students of economics in particular. And economics gives some useful, probably indispensable, answers to the question of how this can best be done. It offers you a growth model, which, by identifying strategic inputs into the growth process, can focus the attention of policymakers on policies required to get growth going. Otherwise, we'd be all over the place. There are too many factors that sort of feed into growth, and you know, we can't get a handle on them unless we have some strategic sense of what's important. And by the way, economists, that's not to say economists agree on what the best policies for promoting growth are. I mean, there is historically a debate which goes on to this day that the best policies are that growth is best promoted by the market, and others would argue that it should be government led. So I mean, that's a debate that goes on, and it's a perfectly reasonable debate to have. And students should be aware that that division exists. Economics also gives one valuable insights which run counter to what might seem like common sense. A lot of people believe that countries rich in natural resources will be wealthier than countries lacking them. History shows that this isn't the case, and economics explains why. People without resources work harder and are more productive. Countries with, say, a lot of oil are like rich people who inherit money. They don't have to work for it, and therefore they don't make it grow. That's known as the oil curse. However, economics also leaves out a surprising number of strategic causes of wealth and poverty. The most important is the ability of the rich and powerful to keep the wealth for themselves. Class power is excluded from the textbooks. It lurks in the shadows of Karl Marx, like a dirty secret which must never be exposed to the innocent student's gaze. So the problem of creating wealth can't be understood except except from apart from the problem of the distribution of wealth and power. Now, the reasons for this silence are quite complicated. It's not because economists are paid by members of the business lobby to keep quiet about this. In fact, as many economists are left-wing as right-wing, probably more. But there's something about the way most of them do economics which blinds them to the role of power, except in the very limited sense of business monopoly in some sectors of the economy. It's the same kind of blindness which allowed them to miss the threat of the uncontrolled expansion of the financial system in the run-up to the crash of 2008. This blindness is rooted in the way they analyse economic phenomena. And just, you know, one obvious example of that, the lack of attention to the institutions through which the economy pulsates. To study the way individuals aim to satisfy their wants without paying attention to the institutions which shape those wants, which transmit those wants, and also value them, is, you know, the main limitation of the economic method. And there is a school of institutional economists who have pointed this out and go on pointing this out, and are confined to the fringes of the profession. It's as simple as that. It's not part of the central paradigm. So I make no apology for talking about method. But to explore the problems that I just sort of summarised, and also to show why the method has been so successful in resisting attack, we need the help of other disciplines. I pick out especially philosophy, politics, sociology, and psychology as fields of study that can expand our understanding of the economy and of human behaviour. And of course, from within the economics profession itself, the sadly neglected fields of history of economic thought and economic history. History of economic thought tells us that throughout the history of economics, the main paradigms have been fiercely contested, and economic history tells us that economic doctrines are products of time and place. They are contextual, and we need to know where the ideas come from that dominate in any period, and that they're not universal laws. They are actually theories which are developed in particular situations, at particular times. And I think that's what we get from studying those. Now, first of all, let me focus just on philosophy. I only want to do one of the topics today. No one can be a self-respecting economist who hasn't thought hard about the philosophical implications of doing economics the way it's done. I also quote John Stuart Mill in my support. He says, no one who is just an economist can be a good economist. The most important aim of economics is to give answers to practical questions. If this happens, what will happen? The point of doing philosophy is to tell you how good the answers are likely to be. In other words, it tells you about the kind of knowledge economics can be expected to give you. We call this branch of philosophy epistemology. But there's also a perhaps more immediately appealing reason for doing philosophy. It sets you thinking about the ends and purposes of economic activity. What's it all for? Is it to make us happy? Is it to make possible a good life for all? That is a branch of philosophy which is ethics. And I want to talk about both of these things, about economics as a science and about economics as a branch of ethics. Let's start with the practical aim. Here are some typical questions economists ask. Will a tax cut make people work fewer or more hours? What will be the effect of an increase in the price of something on its sales? Will a cut in public spending increase or reduce the rate of economic growth? Now, I think the instinctive response of people and to questions of that kind, in fact, I've tried it out on my wife, and she gave me the response I was expecting. She said, it depends. And this happens to be exactly the right answer. It depends, people may add, on all sorts of factors. The answer to the first, for example, will a tax cut make people work fewer or more hours, might be it depends on whether people prefer income to leisure. On the other hand, if I ask the question, if I shake an apple tree, will the dislodged apples fall to the ground or fly up into the air? No one would dream of answering, it depends. The flight of the apple is governed by the law of gravity, and that is the end of the matter. So the first service philosophy can do is to point out the limitations of knowledge in economics and the difference between a human science and a natural science. A human science is different because it deals with human objects and not natural objects. And the flight of the human apple, if we can continue with that image for a moment, is much less predictable than the flight of the natural apple. There are no hard laws governing it. Economics is not a hard science like physics. It doesn't give you certain knowledge about cause and effect. Scientific propositions can be proved. You normally have to be persuaded of the truth of economic propositions. And that's why I agree with Deirdre McCloskey on the whole. She says economics is a persuasive discipline. It's a narrative. It's a story which we find plausible, which we have reasons to find plausible. If economic propositions were provable, economists and others wouldn't need to pay attention to such things as confidence. Confidence is required for stories, not for science. But confidence is the thing that financial papers talk about the whole time. Why? Because we're not dealing with events that are as predictable as the flight of the apple. That is not the way economics presents itself to the world, on the whole. It presents itself to the world as a hard science. It produces hypotheses, tests them, generates laws and predictions. It promises to make policy scientific. But one might be forgiven for thinking that this is largely a PR job. Economics doesn't generate laws. Even its most fundamental law, the law of supply and demand, is misnamed. It depends. Perhaps in most cases, the sales of something will fall if its price goes up, but not if that thing is simultaneously becoming more fashionable. In other words, it depends on the independence of the demand and supply curves, and that is not can't be assumed. The claim of economics to be a hard science, or at least harder than, say, sociology, depends very largely on the precision of its method. At its heart lies the construction and testing of models, usually mathematical models. Well, there you get an interesting observation. Students come to economics to find out about the real world and spend their time learning models. These models, they're told, when mastered, will give them knowledge about the real world. But will it? Will they? What is a model? Do we ever really think about that? What is a model? Well, a model, there are two sorts of models, I think. Well, no, First, generically, a model is simply a set of presumed relationships, usually expressed mathematically, which allows you to infer a causal relationship between X and Y, X being the input, Y being the output. This inference can then be tested against real-world evidence. If it's confirmed, you have a secure explanation of the relationship and a forecast that if X changes, then Y will change in a predictable way. And that's a standard scientific method. Most modelers see their models as slimmed-down replicas of the real thing, a roadmap of reality, something like a model aeroplane or a doll's house. The presumed relationships connecting X and Y are supposed to mimic real world relationships. And again, then why do you use models? If you ask that question, the standard answer is that economics is forced to use models because it can't test reality directly. It's very hard in a social science to set up the experiments necessary to prove your point. In medicine, you can test the effect of a drug by controlled experiments on rats. You can even experiment on humans to a very limited extent, provided they give voluntary assent. Certainly in a free society that would be required. But just think how tricky it is to set up a human experimental situation. Suppose you wanted to investigate the effects of parental drinking habits on the incomes of their children. Even if you could induce some parents to take up drink in the interests of science, it would be almost impossible to set up an initial identity of condition in human households. And this goes for all attempts to test the effect of drugs on human groups. So, models enable economists to replicate experimental situations to a degree. They can control the conditions by assumption, and they can test their inferences by interrogating data. This gives them a limited power of prediction. And I think assumptions are obviously a key tool in model building. Their function is to narrow down the range of conditions or variables necessary for the model to generate testable propositions. But we need to be very careful. To the extent to which assumptions are wrong, the conclusions are wrong. The data being used to test the assumptions has not been generated for that purpose. Another very important caveat. And such limited power of prediction the models possess depend on the stability of the conditions which are specified, which cannot be assumed. And that's why, you know, the truth generated by setting up and testing models should always come with a health warning, the health warning being ceteris paribus. This is true if other conditions, the conditions not being tested, stay the same. And that's not needed for natural science, this ceteris paribus condition, because for all practical purposes, the basic material of the universe, which is the object of study, stays the same. For example, the gravitational constant G and is an empirical physical property used to formulate the gravitational force between two bodies. Without this empirical constancy, there would be no law of gravity. And without empirical constancy of that kind, there can't be any laws of economics. The laws that are suggested are not law-like. They're changeable. They may be temporary laws. They're not hard laws. But what about statistical proofs? I want to say something about the philosophy of proof, because this probably lies at the heart of economics as a problem in establishing itself as a hard science. The method used by economists to verify their hunches or intuitions is econometrics, of course. And the standard definition, econometrics, is the application of statistical and mathematical theories to economics for the purpose of testing hypotheses and forecasting future trends. Econometrics takes economic models and tests them through statistical trials. The results are then compared and contrasted with against real-life examples. Well, it sounds great. You have your hypothesis, you test it, you run regressions, and you come up either with some confirmation or not, some coefficient that is robust. Wait, blah 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 blah. It's all part of the training. But Keynes was one of the first to insist on the limitations of econometrics for discovering truths about the real world. And here's what Keynes said in a letter to Tinbergen, who was the founder of econometrics. He wrote him a letter in 1938. Keynes writes, it's a good letter, so it's worth sort of quoting a bit. If we were dealing with the action of numerically measurable independent atomic factors, and between them completely comprehensive, acting with fluctuating relative strength on material constant through time, we might be able, with some confidence, use the method for disentangling the laws of their action. Even so, our results would be only very approximate. The key point is that X must be independent of Y, and Y must actually be constant, sufficiently constant, stay the same for the period in which the law, for which the law is being suggested. In fact, he says, we know that every one of these conditions is very far from being satisfied. And then he goes on with quite a lot of criticism of how the coefficients are derived, the partial selection, and all sorts of things. And then he says, is it claimed that there is a likelihood that the equations will work next time? With a free hand to choose coefficients and time lag, one can, with enough industry, always cook a formula to fit moderately well a limited range of past facts. But what the hell does this show? What place is left to the state of confidence relating to the future? What place is allowed for non-numerical factors, such as inventions, politics, labour troubles, wars, earthquakes, financial crisis? And so he ends. One feels a suspicion that the choice of factors is influenced by what statistics are available, and that many vital factors are ignored because they are statistically intractable or unprocurable. And he raises very, very important issues concerning bias in model choice, omitted variable bias, the difficulty of inferring causal relations from correlations, the interdependence of hypothesis and data. And they haven't been really overcome. There are ways around them, and econometrics has advanced since 1938 when Keynes made these criticisms. But nevertheless, I think it's still valid to say that the laws discovered by economic inquiry are always conditional. They're conditional on time and place. Well, of course, Keynes' criticism would be completely valid if human beings are like robots, programmed to act in a predictable way, but then they wouldn't be human, would they? Which is why, of course, many business managers dream of having a robotic workforce. One that doesn't go on strike. And that economists like to model economies as a system of interacting robots. Now, you may say that's a slur, but that is a direct quote from Robert Lucas. I like to model the economy as a system of interacting robots. However, I think I won't have a chance to get onto the ethics, so I'll just end with another point about models. Economists don't construct models only to map reality. They also aim to shift reality closer to the model. We may contrast the scientific purpose of model construction with the normative purpose. On this second view, the model represents an ideal. And this trades on the ambiguous way we use the word model in ordinary language. People who model clothes are, as near as possible, ideal types of the human form. We talk about role models. Reformers, social reformers, have set up model communities. Examiners provide their students with, well, they don't provide, they provide their other examiners with model answers to the questions the students are asked. Perfect, optimal are adjectives often attached to this type of model. Many of the models economists use are of this ideal type. The most famous is the model of the perfect market. Now, if that's, you know, the fundamental, is the foundation of your modelling, that is that you view the market as a perfect picture, then you can't bear to see blemishes on it. That's why you describe these blemishes as imperfection. Or they may see the economy as a perfect machine. That's why they refer to frictions. Or they may base their models, they usually are, on equilibrium, which means that they talk about non-equilibrium situations as deviations. This is, you see that the bias in the language actually, you know, directs the path of the study. Krugman writes of the 2008 crisis, or Krugman, the economics profession went astray because economists as a group mistook beauty clad in impressive-looking mathematics for truth. Economists fell in love with the idealized vision of an economy in which rational individuals interact in perfect markets, this time gussed up with fancy equations. You know, you might say that this attempt, this sort of equilibrium thinking, is derived from physics, which is the idea that the pendulum swings but always returns to the same point. And obviously the economist got it from physics, but I think the physicist got it from aesthetics, and that is the perfect forms of Greek sculpture, where everything is in proportion, in the right proportion, and a disfigurement or imperfection would be a defect of proportion. And I think it comes out of that in a way. But it's highly misleading if you're trying to describe reality, because most people don't have perfect forms, and most economies don't have perfect markets. And to describe the actual situation in human affairs as imperfections and frictions and deviations just seems to be to bias the discussion in a completely, not in a very useful way. And you know, the defense of all this is to say, well, what we're doing is not actually describing things as they actually are, but we're setting up benchmarks, standards. But if you set up standards of what is right, you are setting up a sort of momentum to try and achieve those standards. And that seems to me also a delusion. The issue then is how good is, or how good should be, the fit between the model and the reality. The disagreement here is between those who believe that the assumptions should have some purchase on the reality and those who are willing to sacrifice realism to logical elegance, beauty, in Krugman's words, simplicity, and above all, to math. we should notice the rhetorical use of such phrases as market imperfections or market failure. Why is it called a market failure? If we try to build a skyscraper from bits of wood, as in the game of Jenga, and it fell down, we would call it an engineering failure, not a timber failure. So why, when economists insert markets where they don't belong, is it a failure of the market and not a failure of the economist? And the answer surely is that economists want to persuade us not of the truth of their story, but of the truth of their vision. And at this point, politics can't be excluded. Simple models, I'm generalizing, I'm not sure of this generalization. Simple models tend to appeal to the political right, and complex models to the political left. I think students should be alerted to this lack of fit between model and reality very early in their courses, and be encouraged to puzzle out the reasons for it and the consequences of it, rather than just be fed raw models without help. So to sum up, economics tells a good story, a story that has had a great influence on the shaping of economic life. It influences us not because it's true, but because it's persuasive. But it doesn't give a complete account by any means of its own subject matter, and it tells us nothing really about how we ought to live our lives. I just want to make one final observation, if you allow me, which is again about language. Is the notion of good adequately represented by goods and services? Are the goods we buy good for us? To say that something is good is simply to say it's wanted in economics. But there is a difference between what is wanted and what is good. And you know, there's also the idea of service. What do we mean by service? Goods and services. A service is associated with helpfulness. You did me a service. Thank you. But not the service economy. I mean, much of it is extremely unhelpful. But I mean, it has nothing to do with helpfulness. So what's happening is, again, capture ordinary language by economic language, which robs it of its original meaning, and certainly in this case robs it of its ethical value. But now that's a subject for another conversation, so I'll end here. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. That was fascinating, not least for the image of parents taking up drink for the benefit of science. If there are hopefully many questions out there, so please put up your hands. I am going to prioritise questions from students, because this is a student co-organised event, and also Robert is here to talk to students first and foremost. So, you look like a student, so I'm going to get a question.
You have to shout, because I'm going a bit deaf.
I'm a master's student in global development, so we do some economics, but not the proper models of economics that you talk about. I kind of wanted to question something that you said on preferences, that economics assumes the basic level of preference to be it's almost unbiased. It doesn't matter if your preference is for heroin or lettuce. They're both equally valid. And you seem to question that, because surely anyone knows if your friend has a preference for heroin or lettuce, you should get, you know, you should try and encourage them to lettuce. But does that not invite a level of, like, what's the opposite of that? What's the response to that? Because if you don't let individuals set their preferences with economists being completely unbiased as to what those preferences are, does that not invite some kind of elite setting of preferences? And if you're not unbiased about what people's preferences are, who is the one who's setting what preferences should be?
That's the big objection to, that's the big defense of subjectivism, and of treating preferences in this neutral way, that if you don't, someone is imposing their preference on you. And it could be the government, it could be the church, or, you know, whatever it might be. And this is very contrary to contemporary liberalism. However, what answer then do you have to the question, well, we must be allowed to do exactly what we want, subject to some constraint on the harm it might do to others or something like that, which is a classic liberal position. I find that difficult as well. Because what it somehow leaves out is the question: what's good for you? What's good for you? What is good? What is a good life? What are good choices? Now, the only way I think economics can answer that, and this is the ethics of economics, is an instrumental argument. In other words, it comes out of utilitarianism, really, or Benthamite utilitarianism. What is good is what makes you happy. Human beings are so constructed as to seek pleasure and avoid pain. I mean, that begs a number of questions as well. I mean, are pleasure and happiness the same? Is happiness the goal? Is happiness a worthy goal on which everyone can agree? And the answers to that seem actually far from obvious. And there's a further question: does being richer make you happier? Because we actually don't pursue happiness directly. We pursue a proxy called GDP per capita, which is supposed to make you happier. Now, those seem to be quite serious questions that you need to ask on the other side of the argument that you're given. I don't believe that elites should impose their choices on other people. I do think that the idea that people voluntarily make choices which other people, moral authoritarians, seek to curtail is a slightly misleading idea of how choices are actually made, because one of the things that shapes our voluntary choices is relentless pressure of advertising. I mean, we are actually shaped to want certain things, and then we're told that the consumer is sovereign. But the consumer, I don't accept that as a picture, actually. Of course the consumer is sovereign in the sense that when I choose to buy apples rather than heroin, I am at that moment making a choice, and no one else is making the choice for me. But why am I making that choice or any other sort of choice? So I think all those questions, I'm not saying you're wrong, I'm saying some of these things need to be interrogated. These are ethical questions which relate to economics.
Okay, yes.
Right. I'd better say, first, I got a degree in economics 30 years ago. And by the time I got it, I disbelieved a substantial part, some quite important parts of what I had been taught. Still passed the down thing. So, what I'd like, I spent much of the last 30 years on and off thinking through how things might properly work. I'd like to try on you one proposition, which really derives from anthropologists more than anyone else, anthropologists and historians, which is that it's about money systems, and that even in our highly monetized economy, around about or more than half of the money flows are not economic. They're tax, law, religion, sociability. Each of these things is governed by systems of entitlements, rights, duties, obligations, but they are not the same set of rights and duties that govern buying and selling. Now, this is trying it out on you, because it seems to me that seeing our social system, our money system, as made up of these interconnecting and compensating different systems might help frame quite a lot of what you've said, and actually this gentleman's question behind it. Yeah. Now, that's my question, is does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes perfect sense. It's very hard to answer or even comment on very, very shortly, except that the insights from anthropology would be crucial, and I mean maybe one of the things I should add to my list of what economists ought to be aware about is some of the findings of anthropology. I can only give one example from the discussion about the origins of money. Anthropologists do tend to see it as a sort of development of a system of obligations, duties and obligations. And at some point, I mean, they were noted down, and at some point they became transferable through coins and precious metals and so on. Whereas economists don't see it that way at all. They say, well, two boys meet, girls. One has some apples, and the other one has some nuts. And the first one wants 5 nuts, and the second one wants 2 apples. And so they bargain, and they fix on a price. And that is the origins of trade. And in other words, barter is the essential, non-money barter is the essential sort of relationship. They don't have to know each other at all, these people. I mean, it's purely calculated, kind of based on the utility each get from what the other has, the utility they're giving up, and so on. And that money then enters the picture simply as a convenience, a lubricant. And of course, the whole idea of banking is still attached to that idea. What banks are simply intermediaries. They sort of transmit, they make it more convenient to trade. Now, I think all anthropologists point out that they've never found any system in which you have barter without money, and secondly, that such a system is conceptually impossible. Economists have never taken that on board. You read textbook on money. First of all, money only comes in on chapter 25 after having sort of dealt with everything else. And then it says, well, it's a means, what is money? It's a means of exchange. That's all. And they have a few other functions, but they're subsidiary to that. And so, yeah, I mean, the idea that money is at the center of a number of interlocking relations and sets of duties and obligations and is a way of actually negotiating and expressing these is not there. And yet it is a very important factor of how humans organize their lives and how societies organize. So it's a very good point.
The key thing has been that it's even in our society, it's probably still dominant, that it's not economics.
Yeah, you're right.
Okay, thank you.
You're right.
You made a notion on demand not being unlimited and resources maybe not being limited. Because, for instance, in a workplace, we don't use our full capacity. But doesn't the notion of full capacity mean that resources are indeed limited?
That
resources, I think you made a notion of saying resources might not be limited, whereas we think of them as being limited. But he made an example of us in the workforce not using our full capacity every day, every hour. But the notion of there being a full capacity, and as for demand, there just being a set number of people that can do stuff or want something, doesn't this notion mean that there's still a limit to resources?
Well, Not in the actual example I gave, but you may be right that there is a limit at some point. And the example, there's no reason, there's no limit necessarily implied to human capacity. I mean, you know, human potential. You don't say, look, there is a limit. All I was asserting was that human beings are not being active at their full stretch, that there are more resources that can come into play. And that's the whole theory of development as well. And that's why, you know, we don't live in equilibrium systems in which there's a fixed quantity of resources, which as against an unlimited set of wants. So the resources can be increased, but is there a limit eventually to the resources available to satisfy these wants? I mean, we make the problem a lot worse by assuming that wants are unlimited, but nevertheless, let's assume for the sake of argument wants are unlimited. Yeah, the resources of the planet are finite. And therefore, we do come up against limits sooner or later. But to set up economics as though those limits are here and now, as it did right from the beginning almost, it assumed that scarcity was the dominant constraint. That's what one means by a budget constraint. That it was operative always, and that you had to adjust your activities to that constraint. Whereas that constraint was always much more elastic than they assume. And of course, the idea that you might reach a period of abundance was never there because your wants are unlimited. Therefore, you always want more than you have. However rich you are, you want more. I mean, that seems to be the assumption. And that seems to be mad. Actually crazy. So there is a certain craziness in Lionel Robbins' definition.
I've got you. I'm just conscious that the questions have been male-dominated so far. invite... No? Okay, well.
So there was a suggestion in your talk that mathematics has at least played, or at least contributed to some of the problems that we've observed in economics. Do you think there's scope for mathematics to play a role in some of the solutions?
In some?
Of the solutions.
Not, I think, solutions to the problems I was talking about. I'm not saying it can't play a part in solutions to a number of things. I mean, exact calculation is needed for all kinds of things. But to the particular problems I was dealing with, which is the problem of understanding human behavior, understanding the way societies organize themselves, understanding human motives, understanding, getting at a set of values which have some ethical bite to them. I don't think mathematics can really play any role in that. And what I was really pointing out was that it does cut off economics from everything else because people don't think mathematically on the whole. I mean, they learn mathematics as a school subject, and then you know they use it to calculate, you know, how much they have to pay at cash registers. I mean, they don't think in those terms. And I think economists are encouraged to think that, you know, the whole of life is based on this kind of exact calculation. And because other people don't think that way, they can't talk to economists on anything serious. They immediately have a row. And also, you can't do the calculation. You can do some calculations, and you can get probable, you know, probable outcome, and therefore make an approximate prediction, and so forth. You can't do many of them. They're just not They don't lend themselves to that because a lot of outcomes are incalculable. Therefore, you can't count the cost. Right? So, I don't deny that mathematics has a role in many of the things that economics deals with, but I don't think it should be dominant. And the other thing mathematics is used for, which I think is quite illegitimate, is to puff up the pretensions of the subject to be a science. We're the only social science that measures.
Yes.
When did you first start noticing that you didn't necessarily agree with the way economics was being taught? Like, when did you first work out that I don't think this works in reality?
Well, see, I have a particular bias, which I have to admit to straight away. It wasn't my first degree. I mean, history was my first degree, and I did study economics later on, quite a lot. But I always kept that bias. The other bias, which of course I have to admit to straight away, is that I don't naturally think mathematically. I mean, I do some maths, but I don't naturally think mathematically. And therefore, my form of exposition is not mathematical. And if I want to do some maths, I sort of deliberately insert it for pedagogic requirements, rather than because, you know, that's the way I think about this particular problem. So those are my biases, and I don't think anyone who doesn't study maths formally up to first year standard at quite a young age ever overcomes that bias completely. I think that's why people want to get economists young, because then they can sort of program this kind of way. Later on, there's a resistance of some kind. It may be lack of natural capacity, there may be some self-selection in it. But you see, Karl Marx, he got into terrible trouble because he couldn't do maths. Nevertheless, what a colossal achievement. He tried very hard to do maths, and he never could. Another very great economist who struggled with maths was Schumpeter. One knows that from his biography and autobiography. Apparently, on the last day of his life, he was still trying to do something, his equation. I mean, and then he died. so he never cracked it. So when you have examples like this, and this is what the study of the history of ideas can give you, that there are many kinds of talents and geniuses that go up to make the Church of Economics. And it's not just, you know, in one direction. And yet, there is a certain test of professional competence which does, which is established when you do your MSCs. And then if you can do the formulas properly, then, you know, you can go on to your PhD and carry it to a further level. If you don't go through that, you're not a professional economist. You may be something else, you may be good at something or other, but you're not one of our class.
You talked about this perfect equilibrium that they set, and I wanted to know if you think that they do this to set preference to the needs of the market, and can you see a model of economics in the future that perhaps balances the needs of humans and takes into account these relations that he was talking about with the needs of capital adequately?
Well, it wouldn't be economics, it would be something. I mean, it would be, one's got to accept the possibility that fields of study sort of disappear in the form eventually if they don't, you know, if they don't answer enough questions that people are interested in.
So are you saying that economics is completely corrupt and it would have to be something new entirely?
Well, no, you'd use bits of economics, yeah. But the whole axis of the subject would shift. It might not be called economics any longer.
Yeah.
It might be called something else. But I mean, certain of the tools are indispensable. I think we already have some evidence that the house of economics is becoming less populated. And I was aware when I was in the teaching of the economics department at Warwick University that an increasing fraction of certainly our postgrads and MSc students were from abroad, and that the sort of natives were really rather abandoning it. And I think it's because they still bought the magic of economics for development. And, you know, coming back to their countries equipped with this, you know, was a sign that they could take part in the process of getting economic growth in their own countries. So there wasn't yet the disenchantment that I think was, you know, felt to some extent here. And I think there'll be more of that. So economics tries to adapt. So it says, okay, let's talk to psychologists. Yeah, really, interesting ideas. You've been saying this for 50 years, we haven't listened. Never mind, better late than never. Talking about behavioural things, are you? We have sort of an idea that we don't all just calculate everything, but there are other things that are going on. Very interesting, very interesting. And so in some way, there's this sort of belated adaptation of economics to things that other people have been discussing for years and knowing about for years. Suddenly, since the crisis, herd behaviour became sort of a buzzword. Herd behaviour. Really? You mean people aren't independent atomic particles, that they interact with others? Really? How very interesting. We must explore that a bit. Anyway, it's an attempt to adapt to reality, which is good. But you don't have to do it through economics. You can actually take the insights from where they are and try and develop them there. I'm a bit sceptical about behavioural economics. I know it's buzz. Because the trouble with behavioural economics, as I see it, it tends to suggest that human behaviour is irrational. It doesn't in many ways, but it tends to biases in that direction. And I'm a Keynesian. I believe that human behaviour is on the whole rational, but I don't define rationality in terms of rational expectations.
Yes. The cause of the 2008 crash was because behaviour in the financial sector had become divorced from societal norms. And you'll know what I'm referring to if I say they were disembedded. But we haven't done anything to correct that. In fact, the situation is worse. We now have mechanisms in the financial market such as high-speed trading. We have an enormous mountain of ungoverned hot money offshore. There's a rich cocktail that could conspire to make the 2008 crash look like a picnic. Discuss.
There could be an almighty crash. And I think I agree with you. I think very little has been done to correct a reckless banking behaviour either. I mean, I read today, or was it yesterday, in my FT or wherever it was, Barclays 100% mortgages. You know, my alarm bells rang. What did they think they were doing? You see, a lot of people, young people, would say, great, 100% mortgages, I can finally get onto the property ladder. But it's very, very dangerous when, in fact, all the commentary before that was that you should actually make more stringent conditions for loans in order to stop the pile-up of debt that becomes unpayable in the end. But they're going the other way, encouraged by the government that wants a housing boom to happen because they want to not only win the election, Euro election, but to get back into power. So politics plays its part in what's encouraged in the economy and what isn't. The steps to correct banking, you see, it's always for risk. We've got to take steps to mitigate risk. That is the mantra. So we can ask for prudential macroeconomic regulation, capital ratios, all kinds of things. But I don't think it's really addressed the big issue.
Okay, I think we've got time for one more. You already had a go. Yeah, Oliver.
Yeah, thank you very much. Maybe quickly coming back to the maths. I'm pretty good at maths, and I always was. And before I started economics, I was also very good in social things, natural science. And this is why I was so repelled by economics.
Because the maths was so bad.
The maths is very bad. If there would be a very century maths, that would be at least a huge step forward. But this is a side remark. What I actually wanted to say, because you asked for feedback, I actually think that well-being is much easier to be measured than the macroeconomic indicators. Last summer, I tried to give anecdotal evidence. Last summer, I actually tried to read the System of National Accounts. It's a nice 622 pages handbook from the UN Statistical Commission. And understanding measurements of well-being, which I did as well, are much easier. And I think actually more sound in terms of validity.
What, than GDP?
Yes.
Yeah.
I can elaborate on that.
Yeah, it's interesting.
You also said that I'm also come from an ecological natural resource perspective. You said rich countries do not have natural resources. I think this is true now in the 20th century, 21st. But if I think about England, Belgium, Germany,
coal,
iron, wood, water power, stable climate. So I think they were very well endowed with natural resources. Yeah. They converted it into infrastructure. And now they can continue just with labor and knowledge.
Yeah.
And I think Korea and Japan just jumped.
Yeah.
But this might be...
That's valid.
And maybe a quote to end. It's not a quote of me, unfortunately, and I even don't know who said it. But because I was just told a quote. Natural science laws are written in stone. Economic laws are written on paper. And I'd say they're written on sand.
Tell me, what do you, if we have a moment, to elaborate on your criticism of the way maths is used. I mean, in other words, could there be better use of maths in economic modelling?
I think so, because we have many things in economics that are measurable, like money,
yeah,
labour hours, energy use, water use.
But we do try and measure those.
We measure them, but do we have materials, energy, land use in the macroeconomic models, the hours of work, or even the pleasure of work?
Well, how do you see, I mean, do you measure the pleasure of work by asking people?
For example?
Yeah. Well, they do try and do that, you see. What a lot of them, I mean, Easterling is one of the people, yeah, who really started this off, I think. And some of the findings are quite disturbing in terms of the linkage between GDP growth and happiness.
Yeah, I actually would retract that argument now. I think the measurable things are more the physical things and the monetary things.
Yeah.
And we might find useful models to combine those things. Empirical, certainly not pure analytical. This I would, coming from a natural science perspective, and many ecological economists do, we found it very strange that we never put the numbers into the equations.
Yeah.
This is why I actually stopped believing in microeconomics, I think, mid-second semester for me.
Interesting, yeah.
Yeah. So
thank you very much for that.
Okay, thank you all for some fantastic questions. Apologies to anyone who didn't get a chance to ask theirs. If we want, and thank you to lots of students coming out in the middle of dissertations, revision, etc. It's great to see so many of you here. But can we then finally thank our speaker again?
That's a shame.